So what are the criteria for advanced alternative payment models? I'm JP Sharp with CMMI, and I will be leading you through this discussion. So here we'll talk about what makes an APM an advanced APM. So as we spoke about in an earlier module, there's this broad definition of what APMs are. So those are innovation center models, the shared savings program, and any other federal demonstrations. So from there, starting with those payment arrangements, we ask in their terms and conditions, the requirements of those payment arrangements, do they meet these three criteria to be an advanced APM? So we look at those legal instruments that govern how those payment arrangements work, and we ask, do we check these three boxes here? And so first, does that APM require participants to use certified EHR technology? Second, does the APM provide payment for covered professional services based on quality measures that are comparable to those used in the MIPS quality performance category? And then the third one is an either or. So there are two ways to check this box. So either that APM is a specific type of APM that we call a medical home model, and it's been expanded under CMS Innovation Center authority, or the APM requires its participants to bear a more than nominal amount of financial risk. So you check all three of these boxes, and an APM is an advanced APM. So that's what we'll go into the detail in these next few slides about what each of these means in greater detail. So that first criterion for an APM to be an advanced APM is about using certified EHR technology. And so when we say certified EHR technology, we mean the same technology that is used in the Advancing Care Information Performance category under MIPS, so that they're not two separate definitions for certified EHR technology. So when we look at an APM, the APM must have a requirement of its participants that at least 50% of the clinicians in each APM entity use certified EHR technology to document and communicate clinical care. And so what that means is that an APM entity is that participating entity or organization that signs an agreement or is subject to a payment arrangement with CMS. So that can be an accountable care organization, a hospital, a group practice, depending on the type of APM determines which an APM entity means. So you look at that APM entity, and we look at all the clinicians in that entity, and the APM must require that at least 50% of those clinicians use that EHR technology in this prescribed way. For the shared savings program, it's slightly different. So the shared savings program will actually require its participating TINs in each accountable care organization to report to the Advancing Care Information Performance category under MIPS. And by doing that, they'll meet this criterion. So that new requirement that those ACOs report to the Advancing Care Information Performance category under MIPS checks this box for the advanced APM criterion. So the second criterion is about quality measures. And the APM must base payment on quality measures. And those quality measures must be considered comparable to those used in the MIPS quality performance category. And this is a fairly flexible criterion. So what we determine comparable means is that the APM uses quality measures that are evidence-based, reliable, and valid. And those can come from a variety of sources. So they can be actual MIPS measures. They can be consensus-based entity-endorsed measures. They could have been tested in another APM and proved to be evidence-based, reliable, and valid. So long as they are evidence-based, reliable, and valid, then they are considered comparable to the MIPS measures. And then that second bullet there is about outcome measures. So the APM must also tie payment to an outcome measure. There is a slight exception to that if the APM focuses on a specific specialty or clinical condition for which there is not an outcome measure available in the MIPS measure list, then that requirement for an outcome measure does not need to be there for the APM to be an advanced APM. So this is the third criterion, and it's about financial risk. And this one's a little bit tricky, so we have a couple slides based on this. So First of all, we'll look at that second part, which is the one where we'll look at most APMs through this second part of the either-or. And that's, does the APM require its participants to bear a more than nominal amount of financial risk? And I'll note that when we say participants, we really mean that APM entity. So it's the entity that has the agreement with CMS, must bear risk. We do not prescribe how those downstream risk arrangements must be made with individual clinicians or organizations within that APM entity. So we split this into two parts. So first on the left, you see there's financial risk. And on the right, there is how much risk. So first on the left, this is what bearing financial risk means under an APM. And that's the APM may withhold payment for services, it may reduce payment rates, or require direct payment. So any of those structures within the design of the APM itself could be considered requiring its participants to bear financial risk. And then if that's present, then we look on the right side to see how much risk are those entities required to bear. And we focus only on the total amount of risk. And that's the maximum amount that any APM entity could lose under the terms of the APM. And we do that in terms of two different things. So there are two ways that an APM could meet this amount of risk criterion. And the first is looking in relation to the Medicare revenue of its participants. And so the total amount of risk that participants must potentially lose must be at least 8% of the average estimated total Medicare Parts A and B revenues of its participating APM entities. So for those participating entities, they must add up their Parts A and B revenues and ask, does this APM put at least 8% of that at risk? If so, that APM would meet this criterion. The second way we look at this is in relation to the benchmark or the expected expenditures for which an APM entity is responsible under the APM. So that can be considered something like total cost of care for beneficiaries for whom an accountable care organization is responsible, for instance. And this relates a little more closely to how our current APMs usually operate, which is on that total cost of care element. And this just says that the APM entities must be responsible for at least 3% of that benchmark amount of those expected expenditures. And if so, if that total amount that they could lose is at least 3%, then it meets this criterion. So then we have a slightly different take on this criterion for medical home models. And medical home models are a specific subset of APMs. So again, starting with that broad definition of APMs, certain of them are considered medical home models. And we'll identify which APMs are considered medical home models in our materials and on the QPP website at qpp.cms.gov. So we look at certain medical home models in a different light with respect to this financial risk criterion. So first, we look at whether they were expanded under CMS Innovation Center authority. However, none of them so far have met those expansion criteria and have actually been expanded. So we won't discuss that in particular yet. For all those medical home models that have not yet been expanded, we still look at them a little differently, so it's slightly easier for their structure and design to meet this criterion overall. So this parallels what we just looked at for that generally applicable standard for financial risk and nominal amount, but you'll notice there are a few differences in these two boxes. So what we consider financial risk for a medical home model is the same for those first three bullets. So that's withholding payment, reducing payment rates, or requiring direct payments. However, there's a fourth bullet there. So they can cause the APM to lose the right to all or part of an otherwise guaranteed payment or payments. And what that really focuses on are payments that are inherent to that medical home model that are tied to risk or reward under cost and quality components. So that can be reduced in addition to any of those other three bullets. So again, if you have a structure in that medical home model that meets one of those four bullets in their financial risk, then we look at how much is that financial risk. And this is lined up with that first bullet we saw on the previous slide, and we look at the total amount of risk that these APM entities can be responsible for. So how much can they lose at the maximum? And then here it's related only to that Parts A and B revenue. So there's no benchmark-based standard here. It's all associated with the revenue of the participants, and it increases over time. So it starts off for medical home models at the beginning here in 2017. It only must hold those APM entities responsible for 2.5% of their Medicare A and B revenue. However, that will increase to 5% over time and beyond that. So at the end of all this, we don't require everybody to do these determinations on their own or understand all the math within the APMs and line those up against those criteria. What we really do is make these determinations and make them present on our qpp.cms.gov website so that you can go on that site and see our comprehensive list of APMs and understand which of those have met which of the previous criteria that we discussed. And then we will identify each year which APMs are advanced APMs so that participating in these particular APMs here will allow you to receive those rewards that we discussed earlier in the program. So we also like to highlight some future advanced APM opportunities that CMS is working on. And so we've identified that there is the Comprehensive Care for Joint Replacement model, which has already been undergoing and operating, but there's been a change to allow part of it to become an advanced APM. We also are working on a new bundled payment model that will be similar to the bundled payments for care improvement, but will also be an advanced APM when it is released. Then we have advancing care coordination through episode payment models, and there are a series of these episode payment models related to joint care and cardiac care, and there will be an option for those to be at advanced APMs. There's also the newly announced Vermont Medicare ACO initiative that will be an advanced APM. And then ACO Track 1 Plus will be similar to the Shared Savings Program tracks, but will have a significant amount of financial risk relative to Track 1, but less financial risk than Tracks 2 and 3, so that it would still meet the advanced APM criteria, but could be attractive to participants who would not enter Tracks 2 or 3 right away. Thank you for viewing this presentation. For more information, please visit the Quality Payment Program portal at qpp.cms.gov.